So here is the last example for today, the so-called Internet of Things. We sort of saw that already for General Electric, which has putting sensors on their engines. But this is just one example of the so-called Internet of Things, which is just that the world will be full of devices. Those devices will include smartphones, of which I think there are around 6 billion cell phones around at the moment. It includes all the devices in your car. It includes a growing number of devices on your person, because you'll be able to, your whole life will be monitored and recorded, and they will be analyzed to see what's going wrong with you, to be able, just as we can find out what's going wrong with engines and maintain it in time, maybe we can find out what's going wrong with people and maintain them in time. And if we look at what's happening, it's relatively clear that the cloud is a perfect way of managing and analyzing sensor data. And I expect this to increase in importance. That one of the killer apps for the cloud, I said in general, was big data. Well, an important source of big data is the Internet of Things. This is a long tail type application, because remember, every cell, there are these 6 billion cell phones. Each of those cell phones is a little amount of data, but they add up, of course, and the total amount of cell phone processing done in clouds is enormous. And there are all sorts of other examples. You look for the word smart or intelligent or ubiquitous. Those are all examples of where people are building intelligent rivers, they're instrumenting rivers. I mentioned instrumenting people and engines. There are smart homes, instrumenting homes, ubiquitous cities, instrumenting cities, smart grids is instrumenting power grids. And we can expect to see this growing. There's the, we already discussed the application where you put instruments in vehicles. Those instruments in vehicles can both monitor how well you drive them and also monitor traffic jams and things like that by just by telling the back-end cloud how fast the various vehicles with instruments are moving. And these things will support science, some of them, and some will not. And the intelligent river is sort of science, but the smart grid is just supporting the community, as the cell phone type example. I also point out here that another important broad field here is robotics. Robots are likely to grow in importance. Those robots have limited processing power, whatever you can put on the robot. However, there seems quite likely it is natural to take the robot, link the robot to the back-end clouds, and do the processing on those clouds. So if you want to sort of describe that in a simple fashion, if the robot needs to give an answer in a few milliseconds, then it better do the processing on the robot. If it can wait a few seconds, then the processing is better done on the cloud. So this gives you a way of designing robots. You put the things that are needed to be done quickly on the robot. The longer term planning or decision making is done on the cloud. And this is quite easy to implement, because every one of these things of 24 billion devices, each of those 24 billion is roughly independent. Each can be processed independently on the cloud. And that type of independent processing is perfect for parallel computing. It's the easiest type of parallel computing to do, and is particularly effective. So here's the final slide of this set, which basically describes the visually the so-called sensors as a service. Things done on clouds are always thought of as a service. So you have the ability to process sensors available as a set of programs. That's what's called a service running on the cloud. And here's some of the examples we've looked at: webcams, Lego robots, cell phones, Microsoft Kinect, and then the three on the left are the work we've done with Kansas University on data from Greenland, where you have sensors gathering radar information, which radar information is processed on the cloud and sent back to the scientists. And it, in this case here, tells you about the interfaces between glaciers and their bed, or between different layers of snow. And we have a little project trying to make this sensor as a service available more broadly. So that's the end of this unit, and I look forward to telling you more next time. Thank you.